Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today to worship with us here at Mariner Sands Chapel. Let us go, do we have any particular announcements that we need to make today? Any particular announcements? Okay. Then let us do our, say together our welcome and our responsive reading, as is in your bulletin. In God's realm, weakness becomes strength. Fear grows into courage. The wise learn God's foolishness. In God's steadfast love, all things are made whole. Let us pray. Almighty God, today we are here together in your house. We are gathered even not only in your house, but also near your house as people are joining us from outside in their chairs or in their golf carts. And we're glad to have them. And Lord God, there are also people who are joining us at either at this very moment or at a later time today online. And so as those of us who are gathered together, both in person and virtually, we all together just say thank you so much for your love and your mercy to us, for being here in this house as we come. And our focus today is to worship you, to lift your name up, to focus on you in our midst, and to have our lives transformed, and not only ours, but that through our prayers, through the proclamation of your word, through our singing, that our ministry to others would extend beyond these gates into our community and throughout our world. Lord God, may all that we do bring glory to your name, we pray, as your creatures, created by you for praise. Amen. Let us listen to the hymn of praise, number 43, All Creatures of Our God and King, and then you may follow along there in your bulletin. And if you so decide to cheat, it's not my fault. Sunday, we call it Faith and Promise Sunday, and it's the one time of the year that we talk about the way we give to the Lord. And so to talk about that program that we have, a campaign for, we call Faith and Promise, we have the treasurer of our Board of Trustees, Ms. Carol Myers, to come and speak to you this morning. Carol?
Thank you. I hope you don't mind that I take this off, because I don't think those outside will be able to hear me if I keep it on. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
At the beginning of this year, I became treasurer of this chapel, and I stood right here, and I talked about how we here at Mariner Sands, we're like a family. Especially Mariner Sands Chapel is a family, and we're doing God's work. Our chapel is like our family business. I'd like to take a couple of minutes now to update you on how our family business is doing, financially speaking. Last February, we introduced the Faith and Promise program that Gary just mentioned, and we asked everyone who loves this chapel to make a promise of how much they would invest in our chapel this year. I am very happy to report that 119 of our 227 members made a faith and promise commitment for this year, collectively promising to invest $222,495. I'd like to personally thank each and every one of our inaugural year faith and promise givers for your financial support. It sure made my budgeting easier to do. As a reminder, our chapel budget for 2020 is $350,000. That's what it costs to run this place. Despite what a crazy year it's been, our expenses have really not changed much. Whether the chapel building is open or closed, we still need to pay the basic bills every month. We've got salaries, we've got grounds maintenance, we've got utilities to keep the lights on. We have insurance, and we continue to support our benevolent charities in Martin County. In addition, we had to get creative this year, as Gary mentioned, with our online and with our outdoor services. We had to spend about $7,500 in needed video and sound equipment to be able to provide these services, none of which, as a lot of 2020, was not anticipated. Certainly having online and outside worship was not anticipated here at Mariner Saints Chapel. But despite these unanticipated costs, throughout the spring and summer, the chapel was tracking very well compared to our 2020 budget. You may or may not be aware, I know I wasn't aware before I became treasurer, that more than 40% of our annual offerings come in during the month of October, November, and December. Since our chapel reopened for in-person services mid-September, coronavirus 19, has caused attendance to be much lower than we've ever seen. Just look around you, right? It's the middle of November. During October, we received $35,000 less in offerings than we needed. I'm sorry to report that we've fallen another $13,000 short of our offerings budget during the first 2 weeks of November. Hopefully, between now and year end, those individuals who did make those faith and promise commitments for this year will complete them. And also, those chapel members who haven't returned to campus yet, or who choose not, for their own safety reasons, to not participate in person or outside, and maybe they're watching right now, we're hoping that those folks and everyone realizes that our chapel still needs, it's our family business and it needs our financial support. The chapel's past treasurer before me, Ken Slowick, he told me, "Carol, there's a Christmas miracle every year at our chapel when generous individuals help refill the coffers of our family business. I, for one, and praying for another Christmas miracle this year, and I hope all of you will consider being part of delivering that miracle." Now I'd like to turn to next year, 2021. We're gonna set our offerings budget again at $350,000. That breaks down to $38 a week, or $1,500 a year, for each chapel member. Let me repeat that, because I think it's important that we all understand the financials of our family business. To cover $350,000 in operating budget, we need $38 a week or $1,500 a year from each individual member, and you would have to double that for a couple. It would be about $75 a week or $3,000 a year. I want to take a moment and recognize many of you out there who, for long before I got here to Mariner Sands Chapel, have been donating a whole lot more than that, and we greatly appreciate that. Each of us needs to talk with God and ask His guidance on how we should invest in and work our family business next year. At the end of today's worship service, and quite honestly, on some of your chairs, there's a faith and promise card. Looks like this. Faith and promise card. These cards will enable everybody to commit to a certain level of investment that you're comfortable with for 2021. They'll also allow, you'll see that you can select, do you want to commit to invest weekly, quarterly, monthly, or all at one time? That's completely up to you. I'm just going to tell you a little bit of a personal story. I had a hard time remembering to write a check every Sunday morning. And Bob and I would be in our cart on the way over, and he'd go, "Did you bring the check?" I'd go, "Ugh." So I decided, since I use online banking for all of our personal expenses, I just set an online banking recurring payment. So 1/12 of our Bob and my personal commitment to the chapel just gets sent by our bank every month. And that makes it really easy for me personally. I would like to ask that everyone take one of these cards home. Please prayerfully consider what God will enable you to promise to invest in the chapel next year. If you choose to make a payment this year, if that works better for you, but it's for next year's commitment, it's no problem. We can handle that from an accounting point of view. Just write F&P 2021 on the memo line of your check so that we know what year you're giving it for. We'll continue to provide each family a quarterly statement of how much you've already given toward your commitment, and that way you'll always know where you stand. We ask that you return your promise card to the chapel by December 15th, please. So in the next few weeks, I ask you to please ask God, what do you, Lord, want me to promise to support your house and your work here at Mariner Sands? Pastor Carr and the Board of Trustees are hopeful that next year we'll have a commitment to invest in our chapel at whatever level your faith and your circumstances allow from each and every chapel member. If you have any questions about this faith and promise process, I'll stay outside socially distanced after the service, and you can come up to me, or if you feel more comfortable, call Nora or me anytime during the week. I'd like to close with a few words of Paul in the 9th chapter of his second letter to the Corinthians. Paul said, "Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Thank you, and may God continue to bless you and keep each one of you safe.
It was 301 years ago when Isaac Watts wrote the immortal words to the notes that you're now hearing. A great hymn classic was born. O God, our help in the ages past, which is based on Psalm 90. Listen and be inspired by our own choir, and remember, our God of help in the ages past is our God of the present, and our God and hope for the future. Oh,
Prayer. Before we go to that, I just wanted to mention that this hymn, Holy God, We Praise Thy Name, may be a little unfamiliar for some of you. And what I found is my secret hidden agenda is that since you don't know some of these hymns, and since we're not singing them, this is a great time for you to learn and listen to them and hear them for the first time, maybe, and so that when there comes a time when we can sing them, they'll be a little more familiar to us. But this has been terrific. I love that hymn, and it does really say so much. Lord of all, we bow before thee, all on earth. Your scepter claim, all in heaven above adore thee. Infinite is his God, is God's vast domain, and everlasting is his reign. So let's pray together. Again, Almighty God, today at our time to pray, we're here to intercede on behalf of others. Others who, for one reason or another, could not join us in person. They may be joining us online, or maybe not even that. So for those who are on your agenda today, Lord God, we want to intercede. Who are these people that we are praying for today, God? They're the needy. They're the hungry. They're the afflicted. They're the ones who are beset by family troubles, by squabbles, by hate and discontent, by arguments, by bickerings, by the typical family stuff. Lord God, we pray for these people. For those who are ill, who have been hospitalized this week for one reason or another, we pray that your healing power would be upon them, delivering them from whatever illness or disease or injury they have occurred, that has occurred. Lord God, we want to pray for those mighty ones in our community, the first responders who boldly go into the flames, into the crisis, and create peace and order out of disorder. For our first responders, fire, police, EMS, dispatchers, and those who work in emergency services. Sometimes, God, they rarely get thanked in person. So our thanks today to you is on their behalf, that you would bless their lives, that you would sustain them today, keep them safe in their work. We pray for our elected leaders that it would go well with them and that our lives, our government, our structure of our community would be stable and safe in the coming months ahead. Lord God, we pray for our relatives. That may be our children or our grandchildren, our brothers and sisters. We just breathe a prayer of intercession, God. Would you do a miracle in their lives today? And give us wisdom as to how we could be possibly a blessing to their lives. Lord God, we look forward to this week with great anticipation that perhaps something will catch our attention and we will sense that it is a divinely inspired moment that we will respond as a believer in faith and do something good, say something good, or just be a listening ear, a comforting presence to someone in need. And may that be an extension of evangelism and grace in our community. Help us to do our very best to build your kingdom, the kingdom that was built on the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever and ever.
He sees the nail-scarred hands above my
Sometimes you just sing greatly, other times you just sing anointed. So thank you for that today. Our second reading comes from the second letter to Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 7. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and then even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves, first of all, to the Lord, and then by the will of God, also to us. So, we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see to it that you also excel in this grace of giving. May God add his blessings to both the reading and to the heeding of his holy word. Thanks be to God. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So let me just mention a couple things in passing as I bring a message today, and it's entitled Worship in a Digital Age. My microphone. It's always something. But I have a backup, so we're all set. But if I turn around and you see a little tail behind me, that's just a wire, so don't worry about it. It's nothing's growing. At our church, we receive a magazine called Bible Study Magazine, and if you would ever like to read that, you can pick that up or sign it out or use it, and if you want to use it for your own encouraging study, just want to let you know that I have a subscription to that to help us. This message comes from the prophet Isaiah in a roundabout way to address a current topic, and it's a subject that really has no reference in the Bible, since all the terms that we talk about when we talk about digital things, all those terms have been coined in the last 50 years. This makes really any topic on technology a difficult one, as God's word is pretty much silent on the subject of advanced technology. But it has numerous allusions to it if you're willing to accept a larger context for the subject. Now, God has used technology throughout history with Israel and with the church. The technology may be neutral. The design and the purpose of the technology is also useful until it has been marred by sin or distorted by human selfishness. From humanity's dawn of civilization, God has given us assigned tasks to fulfill with our hands, to tend to the earth, to build it up, to create structure and have dominion over creation as God's stewards. And in our lifetime, just our lifetimes, we have witnessed the message of God's love to go out throughout the world through the human voice, through amplified sound, print, radio, television, recorded metal tape, remember that? CDs, DVDs, streaming media, social media, virtual media, digital media. How in the world could people 20 centuries ago have imagined such a vast spectrum of communication? All of these innovations have really been incredible in the sense that they've made the Bible, for example, more accessible to everyone on earth more than ever in human history. These venues have changed the way we worship as well as the way we find Christian fellowship. I think the jury's still out on whether these technologies are good or bad. What is good about the digital age? Well, you're always reachable. What is bad about the digital age? You're always reachable. Now, perhaps that's the wrong question to ask. A more reasonable question is, in what ways have our thinking about God and our worship of Him changed? Ralph Waldo Emerson summarized it well years ago, and he said, "This time, like all times, is a very good one if we but know what to do with it." Generations grapple with this emerging digital change on a global level. Where's my little card? Here we are. Today, whether you're aware of it or not, Twitter is sending out 6,000 tweets per second. That's 500 million tweets just today. You know how that we joke about and we say, hey, there's an app for that? The applications that are available on our computers and our iPhones or our digital devices, just on the App Store alone, there are 2.2 million apps, and 1,048 apps are being added every day. Facebook. Do you know that Facebook is the largest country in the world? There are 2.5 billion monthly users of Facebook. TikTok. You may not have heard TikTok. It is also one of the largest countries in the world with 800 million monthly users. Snapchat. You probably don't know what Snapchat is, but your grandkids do. There are 300 million people, most of them under the age of 25, and that's how they're communicating without you even being aware of it. The digital age. Now I'm going to come over here and talk to you about something that's kind of funny and kind of frustrating at the same time. There's my cord. Don't want that in there. So this week, I got to stay here because the other microphone doesn't work. All right, sorry. So this week, I had the oddest experience. Karen and I, on Friday, we were, you know, frogging around, you know, spending our time off just to relax. And I went to a modernized hardware store. And being a man of old age, and you travel, at some point, you have to use a restroom. And so I go into the bathroom, and I'm going to do my thing. When I walk into the bathroom, the light comes on automatically. And I thought, well, that's kind of nice. I'm used to, like, having these sensors, you know. But what shocked me was the toilet lid went up automatically, too. And so I thought, I'm kind of technologically savvy, so I'm good with this. And so I go over and I stand over the toilet and do my thing. Now there's a little blue light going on, you know, on the side of the toilet. It's like ultraviolet sanitizing or whatever. And I'm sorry to say this, but when I finish, there's no latch to, like, you know, flush. It's like digital, I guess. And so I set the lid down, nothing happens, I open up the lid, it's all by myself, no one's seeing me, you know, so. But it's like, and I just wonder, well, where do you, you know, and so I just said, you know what, there's an 18-year-old who knows how to do this, and so I'm just going to wash my hands and go. And so, Lexi, wherever you are working the cash register, I hope you have a remote on that toilet, because I have no idea how that thing works. And I say that really in kind of seriousness, in that we're a little frustrated by all this digitization in our culture. And that here I am, 65 years old, and I don't know how to flush a toilet. I mean, where was I when the designers were out? And so that's where it gets evil in design. And if you're designing toilets like that, shame on you. But that's the point, isn't it? I mean, technology is supposed to help us, and it's like, oh, it's touch-free or whatever. Yeah, it's really loaded with problems for those of us. And brothers and sisters, this is where the application hits us. We are the last generation that has an analog understanding of humanity. We're the last ones. We're it. So until we pass down the gifts of actually doing something in person with our hands, if we don't pass those on to our children and our grandchildren, they're gone. I was in a tire store or somewhere, a store where the TVs are always on no matter where you go. And I was in a store sitting in a waiting room, and Ellen DeGeneres was on. And she had a young lady come up who was about 18, and they were going to play a game. And the game was, you have like 2 minutes to do these three tasks. The first was to fold up a highway map. Now, if you're with me, there is a way to do it and a way not to do it. Don't ask me about it, but I mean, there is a way. She was absolutely clueless as to how to fold up a highway map. The second task was to look in this big book on the table that was about that thick, and all the pages were a goldenrod color that we know as the yellow pages. And she was supposed to look up Paul's muffler shop. She was completely lost. Looked up under the letter P for Paul. And then the last thing is when she found the phone number for Paul's muffler shop, she had to get on a dial phone and actually dial the number. So, you know, she's tinkering around with it, dials the number, finally figures it out, and then picks up the receiver to listen to see if the call goes through. So you see, this is where we're losing it. So where does the text of the scriptures come in from Isaiah? God is going to do a new thing. God is completely hip to all our newness. But if you read Isaiah 43 and chapter 44, which we didn't have all the time today to do this, but it's very important in those two chapters, and this is where your Bible reading really comes through in some points. In 43 and 44, it's talking about how in this age, in Isaiah's time, people would take wood and they would make things out of wood. They would throw the wood into the fire. They'd take the wood out of the fire. They'd make an idol and they would worship it. And this is the thing that God detests, is that we would take the things that we have made and turn them into objects of worship. Now, I'm not going to meddle, but let's look at our objects of worship today that we carry with us. Well, not all of us. But I'm telling you that there will be archaeologists someday who will look at our generation and say, what was that thing that people carried with them all day long? This little thing that is the very first thing you look at in the morning, the last thing you look at before you go to bed, the thing that goes into the bathroom with you, the thing that sees and hears everything you're doing. Hey, Siri. She's listening. Hey, Siri, tell me a joke.
What kind of dog can jump higher than a building? All of them. Buildings can't jump.
Isn't that nice that I've got someone to tell me a joke every day? Isn't that nice? So how does this affect our worship? Well, it affects it greatly. And that's what Isaiah is telling us, is that whatever you fashion, no matter how hip or how cool it is, do not leave the creator of your youth. And remember that all this technology is there for us to use and not to be the object of our worship. It's not to replace God. Science loves to replace God because all science does is observe. So when you listen to the scientists about anything, you're listening to people who are observing things. Science does not look at the moral purpose, or science does not look at the origin of anything, because it cannot see the origin of anything. It only analyzes, identifies, categorizes, and creates a structure about what already is. Brothers and sisters, science can look at all the things going on in your body. They can even look at what's going on in your mind. There's a professor at Duke University, her name is Nita Farnahay. She's a professor of law and of ethics at the School of Law at Duke University, and she has a wonderful lecture about data today, that in the future, all those passwords that you have trouble remembering when you're logging on to different websites on your computer, don't worry, in a few years, you'll put a small little brimmed hat on your forehead, and it will give EEG readings of your brain waves, and your password will be replaced by a pass thought that cannot be duplicated. So all you gotta do is look at the computer screen and think of the pretty flowers in front of the chapel, and boom, your app goes open. So that's the future. That's your digital natives children's future. There's a physician in Los Angeles who has studied the brain and has discovered that in this generation, this digital age, when we look at our iPhones or our laptops, whatever that is, it actually creates a pleasure center in our brain, and it stimulates the frontal lobe of our brain. Why do I say that? Have you ever, those of you who are guys, and you're driving down the road, and things are, you know, kind of a little hectic in traffic, and your wonderful bride is talking to you at the same time, and the radio is playing, and there's just all this stuff, and when things get really hectic, do you ever find yourself turning the radio down so that you can, like, pay attention to her? So you're driving, do you ever do that? That's because the frontal lobe of our brain is the executive function of our decision making, and so when it gets overloaded, it starts shutting down things. And so when computers or digital images start overriding your frontal lobe, guess what? You start shutting down and you're thinking less. Your executive function, the doctor has determined and analyzed and quantified and researched and validated, the neural networks are actually changing. Your brain is changing how you process information because of the digital age. I know it's true. I was at Publix the other day, and I bought some groceries, and of all things, I did something completely old school. I paid cash for my groceries. She said, that's $19.62. Now, I could have given her the Visa, which is probably why we're going to credit cards, but instead I gave her 20. She looked at that thing and she said, she started making punches into a screen. She said, oh, I punched the wrong thing. I don't know how much to give you back. I said, 38 cents. Because we get it. This is what's getting lost in our society, that children under the age of 30, they're not adding anymore. They just wait for the screen to tell them what to do. So our wellness is being affected by the digital age. Our witness is being affected by the digital age because we're doing more sharing through email or electronic media than ever before. Rather than seeing face to face. We've seen here in our own community how people can say such tragic, horrible, embarrassing, rude things through email because they don't have the courage to face someone and say it up to their face. So they troll and they say mean things to one another. Shame on them. They need to repent. That's just not right. And words do hurt, even if they're from a digital platform or they're face-to-face. It affects our witness. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, I want you to know that not only is Siri listening to you, but the Holy Spirit is watching every move you make, and it's all recorded in heaven. May all your deeds be Christ-like in all that you do. If you've made a mistake, ask God for forgiveness, but then work out your own reconciliation process if you've made that difficult thing with someone else. Work to reconcile yourself. The digital age has affected the Word of God. I study the Word of God now probably more on my computer than in the Bible, than in the print version itself. Why? Well, it's just because I've got 3,000 books on my laptop computer, and when I open it up and I put in a Bible verse, I get 60 commentaries in less than a second opened up right to the place I want to see it. I can look at it in Hebrew, I can look at it in Greek, it will translate that, I'll get dictionaries, concordances, all in less than a second. It's transformed, and so I'm a better Bible student now, thanks to the digital age. But you know what? There are days when I just want to sit in the sunroom, and I just want to spend time and just read a very private thing, just read a little text, and so should you. And not only that, but it would be a great help to your spirit if you would take just a small piece of text, a small piece of God's Word, hide it in your heart, memorize it, and then just sit and think about it and ruminate it over and over. Chew on it. Let it kind of go back and forth like a cow chews the cud. Just let it get various tastes. Like Psalm 32:8, I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you should go. Just say that in different ways. Put a different emphasis on a different word. I will teach you. I will teach you and instruct you in the way which you should go. These are the kind of things that we can do, keeping those analog habits alive. It affects our word, and then, of course, it affects our worship. So sometimes, you know, we intentionally do not have lots of screens. We don't have the dancing ball up front. We don't have too much, you know, we don't have the dance floor out front. I've been in churches where they actually have to bring bottles of water because they work up such a sweat in worship. You know, they need to refresh themselves before the offertory. And we don't have to do that here. We keep it kind of low tech to a great ways. But we have improved, and that is we have a camera now that actually captures everything through digital so people can watch us. That's an improvement. And we've made outside, as you can hear, from the speakers outside, you can now hear us from outside and inside, so we've created a sound system. And we've expanded our bandwidth, and that is the Wi-Fi signal. If you haven't already, if you've already checked your email during this worship service, no, don't worry, God knows, but I don't, but it doesn't matter. I'm just saying that we have a new Wi-Fi login here. Our bandwidth has increased to over 100 megabytes per second, so we're nice and lightning fast for you. You'll get your texts, and it's just called MS Chapel. So when you look on your iPhone and you say, "Hey, what available networks?" MS Chapel is the Wi-Fi. So digital worship has changed our life. The digital age has made us addicted. The parents, as well as children, spending an average today of 8 hours or more every day on the digital world, their other life. All your activity, all your hidden activity is being watched and it's being recorded, whether it's by Siri or Google or other platforms. So be careful. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little eyes, what you do, what you see. Awaken your relationship with every connection that you have with technology. I'm not being a naysayer, I'm being a pastor to say your spiritual self is designed by God to respond to God. And don't be lulled into a false sense of worship that isn't really with God. Another verse of scripture from the Apostle Paul from Romans 12, do not be conformed to this digital world, but be transformed by the renewing of your unplugged Christ-like mind. Use technology skillfully for the glory of God. Every January, you should have a conversation with your loved ones and say, you know what? I think we should create a new set of rules about how we handle our iPhones, our cell phones. Should we have them at the table? Should we set them aside? Should we put them aside somewhere else so that they're not on the bedside beside us? Maybe you should think about the fourth commandment that God gave Moses, keep the Sabbath holy. And maybe you should think about, you know, I don't need to go to Pinterest or Poshmark on Sundays. I can wait till Monday. I can wait before I have to bow before the iGod Amazon. I can wait and just keep my Sabbath set apart. Because I guarantee you, brothers and sisters, you will be forwarded no email in heaven. You will cancel that email account because you'll have the mind of Christ. Obviously, I can't do justice to this message. It probably should be a whole Saturday morning seminar. But you see, I'm pretty gassed up about it, aren't I? Now let me close with this. I know I'm a little late. But I'm earnest about this. And I just want you to know that this is also Faith and Promise Sunday. So it's like, how do we like put the clutch in, shift into a whole other gear and go into low and then talk about another subject? So let me just briefly talk about this other subject called the Faith and Promise Plan. What is it? You know, you don't have to tell me how uncomfortable it is when you go to church and you're told something about money. So every time I say the word money, I want you in your mind to hear this word, manure. There we go. That's easy now, isn't it? When I talk about manure, you get that. And you know that if I stack up a pile of manure right here on the pile, it's a stinking mess. But if I take that manure and I put it out in the gardens all around here, everything's going to grow beautiful. The Faith and Promise Plan is this. It's taking our physical resources, our economic resources, and it's not giving what you have now. It's by faith saying, God, what's possible next year from what I do not have now? What is possible? And then just listen. That's what it is. And then you have time to think about this. What is God saying to you? It doesn't matter what the amount is, because God owns it all. He owns it all. And as we read from 2 Corinthians, this grace is a grace that should be something that joyful. It's a grace that we have. In the midst of a severe trial, the text says, can you relate to that? Their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. I can't exegete that any clearer. So think about what's possible with God, because he owns it all. If you wanted to say, God, I'm going to commit to you $1 million, that's on God, not on you. That's on God. And guess what? Forget $1 million. Just forget that. Just forget that. Erase that from the video. But the fact is whatever the amount is, imagine that. Well, won't that be cool when God provides that? Because then, when it comes into your life, you'll say, "Oh, I didn't engineer that. That's a God thing." How do you feel when God brings something into your life that you could say, "Oh, since He provided, I gave it away." And that's why every living organism in the world doesn't worry about what they're going to eat, where they're going to sleep, or what they're going to do today, because instinctively, they know God provides. They instinctively. And so this faith and promise is such that we're instinctively using our spirit to talk to God, listen to God, and then we're only promising what God has told us. And if God doesn't deliver, that's on Him. And it's a way to turn it around so that we don't want to give our tithes and our offerings out of guilt, That's just, I feel rotten when people say that, like, but it is. He's coming around. When I come to shake your hand, I can't shake your hand, but I reach around with the other hand, feel if you got your wallet close by. You don't want any of that. You don't want that guilt. You want to rejoice with me, like I'm rejoicing with you, how God is providing for everything pertaining to our lives and godliness. Why do we do it? It's so that we don't make anybody feel guilty, and it's so that those who are in leadership and servantship here at the chapel, they just plan. They plan a ministry based on what we give. That just makes sense. So I close with that part of the message, that is, it's a faith and promise that you want to participate in because you want to see how God's going to do this in your life. That's a great way to plan ahead. Just look forward to 2021, say, I have no idea what's going on, how much I'm going to come in contact with, but I do know that whenever God brings that amount into my life, I will know exactly. I have a partnership with God that I will provide for his kingdom with the resources he provides. Is it fair enough? Just shake your head and say, yeah, that's fair enough. Does anybody disagree? Just meet me outside and we'll go fight it out, but because I'm right and you're wrong, so. The digital age is upon us. The philosophers long ago said, what is the good life? That was the thing. What is the good life? Christ came into the world to model for us that the only good life that matters is the holy life, the life that's completely set apart to honor God in all that we say, all that we think, and all that we do. Flee whenever technology or digital involvement becomes an idol. If you're addicted, it's time to start weaning yourself off and going on a digital diet. You'll know. I'm telling you, you'll know, because you'll see that it's your excessive use, or that when someone takes it away, you ask a 5-year-old, a 10-year-old, you take away their iPhone, you got their attention. It's worse than being grounded. If you take away, so deprivation, or when you take something, withdrawal, that's how you know that you're addicted to it. Or if your level of tolerance is changing. Anyway, flee when it becomes an idol. Use it skillfully. Use all technology skillfully for the glory of God. Let's pray. Again, Almighty God, so I did it. Lord, I gave him the message that you wanted me to say. And it's hard, because I'm preaching to myself as well as to everybody else. Make us good stewards of our time, both online and offline. Grant us peace in this age of change and turmoil. Lord God, help us to live slower, not faster. Help us to live more permanent, not so temporary. Help us not to seek more knowledge, but more wisdom. Help us to be more holy, not more happy. Help us, Lord, to find the victory over the addictions that take your place. We ask in your precious and holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 277. Most people know, this is probably my favorite hymn. So those of you who are my age, when I'm dead, they'll be playing this at my memorial service. This will be one of them. Victory in Jesus. Let's stand together. We'll sing a benediction. And there are a few people here who are very concerned about their interactions with other people, keeping their safe distancing. So while we sing, or while we listen to, or however we interact with the victory in Jesus, there are those of you who need to go out now so that you will have safe distance from other people. And this is your time together, okay? We honor and respect your medical and social concerns. So, victory in Jesus. Tim, would you play that for us? thank you again for worshiping with us today. And the offering baskets, boxes will be out back for you. We'll dismiss by rows so that everyone can have a safe exit. Will you receive a benediction now from the book of Jude? To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you richly today.